He was already 30 years old when he set out on his ministry. The name Jesus was a common one at the time. People in his remote hometown didn't see him as a great preacher. They didn't consider him special. In fact, they ran him out of town the first time he tried to return home. To some, he was a prophet. To others, he was a miracle worker or a healer. To the religious establishment of the day, he was a challenge to their authority. As his popularity grew, there was talk of him being the promised Messiah. Some even called him the Son of God. He traveled the countryside with 12 main disciples, though others followed close behind. He would preach his truths to one person face to face, and then to 5,000 on a hillside. Woven into his teachings, there came more and more talk about his own death, first in masked terms, then ever more clearly. For centuries, a prophet who was anybody was bound to end up in the holy city of Jerusalem. The road to Jerusalem drew Jesus like a magnet. Entering the city is where we find him today. There is much excitement and enthusiasm. Adults want to touch his cloak and be near him. Children just want a chance to see him. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Glory to the King of Kings. Hosanna in the highest.
Thank you.
as there was great excitement as people came into the streets to see Jesus. As Jesus came into town on a donkey, the people waved palm branches and then laid them on the road, and he passed. Some laid down their coats. The whole city was disrupted. The authorities were not happy. The people who came out to see Jesus understood that he wasn't an ordinary visitor. However, they still didn't realize that his ministry in their city would eventually lead him to a death on the cross. When Jesus arrived in Jerusalem, it was time to celebrate the festival of the Passover. Many people traveled to the city of Jerusalem to do that. The Passover was usually a special meal that was eaten with family and friends. They remembered the night, long ago in Egypt, when the angel of death passed over the houses of the Israelites. It was a party to celebrate that Moses led the Israelites out of slavery and into freedom. So Jesus gathered with his friends for the Passover too. He gathered them all together because he wanted to tell them how much he loved them. He wanted one more opportunity to celebrate and to have dinner with them. There was food and there was wine. Then during the supper, Jesus got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around his waist. He poured water into a basin and began to wash the feet of his friends. After he washed their feet, Jesus put his robe back on and returned to the table. Then he told them they also should wash one another's feet.
Then he would go away. As they sat around the table, ready, willing, strong, and able, Jesus broke the bread and then was heard to say, had dined, Lord Jesus poured a cup of wine, giving thanks, he shared the peace, and then, well, he said he'd have to die, and when they asked him why, Jesus passed the cup and told them once again.
All stopped eating and drinking, and he told them that one of the men in the room would betray him. This person was going to turn Jesus over to his enemies, and eventually Jesus would be tried for blasphemy. The room became very somber, and the disciples were distressed. They began to look at each other and say things like, "Surely it isn't me, Lord, is it? I can't be the one to betray my Lord." Who would be the betrayer of Jesus?
After all the questions about who would turn Jesus over to his enemies, he finally announced that it was going to be the one who dipped his hand in the bowl with him. It was going to be his friend and his fellow disciple, the man named Judas. Now everyone at the celebration was surprised, and many of them were upset. They were even mad that this had to happen. But someone had to be sure that God's plan was carried out. And Jesus knew that it was necessary. It was hard for people to continue to eat their food. And then there was yet one more surprise. As they were still gathered around that table, Jesus took some bread. And he raised it up before them at this Passover meal, and he broke it. And he gave thanks to God for it. And then he turned to them and said, "You eat this bread, And every time you eat this bread, remember that I am with you and that it is given for the forgiveness of your sins. Well, they were surprised, but they continued to eat until they were almost done with the Passover meal. And Jesus then took a cup and he said, "This cup that I hold in my hand, this is the new covenant in my blood. And it's given for you and you and you and all of you. And every time when you drink from this cup, remember that your sins are forgiven because I am with you." Now, nearly over 2,000 years later, Jesus still comes to us and invites us to share in that Passover meal right here, right now, in this place. Servants, would you come forward?
This is
on that final night that Jesus gathered with his friends to eat the Passover meal, he not only gave them the gift of his body and blood, but he also gave them a new commandment. He told them that he had always loved them. He told them that he would always love them, and that nothing could stop that love from flowing forth. Then he said to them, "You too should love each other just as I have loved you." Passover meal, Jesus took a few of his disciples with him to the Garden of Gethsemane. For Jesus, this was a crossroads of his life and ministry, both figuratively and literally. Gethsemane was located at the edge of Jerusalem. It was a quiet place where one could think and pray. Gethsemane means olive press. There were many olive trees in this lush garden. Jesus and his disciples got to the garden. He told them to sit and wait for him at the gate. He took two of the men with him, and he went into the garden to pray. He prayed, "Abba, Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but your will be done." Jesus didn't want to die. But he also knew his job was to do the will of God. was in this garden that Jesus knew the time had come for him to die. When Jesus finished praying, he went back to the rest of his followers, and they were sleeping. This upset Jesus. He knew that the time of his death was coming, and he was disappointed that his friends couldn't even stay awake a few minutes while he was praying. Then they came. The soldiers came out with torches and swords to arrest Jesus as if he was a bandit. After the angry hordes took Jesus away, the disciples left in the garden were afraid. They were afraid for Jesus, and they were afraid for their own lives. They weren't really sure what would happen to them now that Jesus had been led away. If the mob was willing to arrest Jesus, what might happen to his followers? Would they be the next ones to be arrested? Even Jesus' good friends became reluctant to let others know that they knew him. The soldiers took Jesus to the high priest's house. His disciple Peter followed in the distance. Jesus was in the courtyard of the high priest. His disciple Peter remained at the gate. The woman who guarded the gate claimed that Peter was a disciple of Jesus, but he denied it. The slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire and were standing around it. Again, someone asked Peter if he was a follower of Jesus. He again denied it. Finally, one of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, claimed he had seen Peter in the garden with Jesus. Peter denied it. The rooster crowed.
Stand up and look at me when I'm talking to you. That's better. You know, they brought Jesus to me after they arrested him in that garden. I had him stand before me, just like you're standing here right now. I asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And he gave me some sarcastic answer. He said, "That's what I said he was." So I asked him again, "Are you the King of the Jews?" And even though all these people were there, ready to tear him apart, he did not say one word to defend himself. It was crazy. He seemed crazy. I was amazed. Can you believe it? He wouldn't even answer me, the governor. The people just wanted him dead, and he wouldn't say a single thing to defend himself. So, I decided to do what I do every year at the Passover. I released one prisoner, set him free, makes me look good. You know, people like that. So I called this Barabbas out of prison. Now he was a real dirtbag, a murderer. And I stood him next to Jesus and I asked the people, "Who should I set free?" And you know what they said? They said Barabbas. Can you believe it? I mean, this meek man Jesus and this murderer, and they chose Barabbas. You look at me when I'm talking. Thank you. The people wanted this murderer to go free and this meek little man to be arrested in his place. So I did what they wanted, I released Barabbas. Then I asked the people what they wanted me to do with this Jesus. And they yelled, "Crucify him." Yet, they told me they wanted me to kill him using a brutal form of capital punishment. You hang on someone on a post till they die. Put nails through their hands and their feet. It's humiliating, it's ugly. They said, you know how they die? They suffocate. Sometimes we even hang them upside down. All the blood rushes to their head. Once in a while we use a cross, that's what we did with Jesus. They suffocate because they just can't get that air into their lungs. You know, it's not a pretty story. But then again, you came to me, so I'm telling you the way it was. It's not a happy thing, but this is what the people wanted, so I washed my hands of it. I had nothing more to do with the matter. And now I must go. I'm Pilate. I'm the governor. I have no time for you children and this choir.
You are my all in all. take up his crown and lift it high, till every eye has seen the Lord. Lift up the crown.
The followers of Jesus look on in bewilderment and sadness. Some of them had left everything to follow this man from Nazareth. They had seen him perform miracles, and they thought he had come to Jerusalem to establish a new kingdom. But now they watched in disbelief as the one they called Lord was taken out and nailed to a cross.
He saw a man lying dead on the street. face is calm, his breath is still. Now his soul is in God's hands. When the spear is thrust into his side, it is clear he is gone. The Lord has died.
Jesus died on the cross. The Lamb of God, the Word made flesh, the Savior of the world, was hung on a cross to die. To be sure that he was dead, soldiers pierced his side with a sword. People came to this hill called Golgotha to witness this death. People mocked Jesus on that cross. People asked him to come down from that cross, come down and save himself if he was really a king. Eventually, the soldiers cast coins for his clothing. It was a sad day. Death brings sadness into our lives. Our hope on this day of Jesus' crucifixion is that he truly did love each one of us.
Triumphantly into Jerusalem. He celebrated the Passover with his friends. It was an exciting time. But now we have seen his life violently taken from him. Jesus was killed because his accusers believed he blasphemed God. His disciples have fled in fear. Just before sundown on the day of his death, a secret follower of Jesus named Joseph, who lived in Arimathea, got permission to remove Jesus' body from the cross and took it to his own tomb for burial. It was a very hurried affair, for the sun was about to set, and Jewish law forbid work to be done on the Sabbath day.
Joseph. I come from the small Jewish town of Arimathea. I have been waiting for the arrival of the kingdom of God. I believed that Jesus would be able to bring us that kingdom, but then they killed him. I don't know what that will mean for me or my friends. Is Jesus the one we've been waiting for? I went to Pilate and begged for the body. I still believe that Jesus is needed to be treated with honor and respect the way he treated everyone when he was living. I didn't have much time, so I quickly wrapped the body in a linen cloth, and then I put it in a new tomb that I had hewn from the rock. Now I'm tired, and I'm scared. Jesus is dead. Everything is confused. Was he the Savior I hoped for? I just need to be alone. Please, just leave me alone.